thank you for joining. I'm Michael Barbero, I work for the Foundation. Today we'll talk about Kubernetes and a little introduction to Kubernetes. I've learned Kubernetes for the last 6 months because we are currently installing OpenShift, which is a Kubernetes distribution at the Foundation. And I found the technology so amazing that I wanted to share how it works with you. So first, I do some... I assume that most of you are familiar with Docker technologies, but can you raise your hand if you're familiar with Docker? Okay, awesome. For those who don't know what is Docker, how it works, it may be a bit hard to follow. I'm sorry about that. So what is Kubernetes? So Kubernetes is a container management or orchestration system which run and manage the application on a cluster, application which are containerized. But what does it really mean? What does it provide to you? So these are a couple of stuff that you can do on Kubernetes. So for instance, you can run five containers of an application and automatically place a load balancer in front of it, in front of these five containers. You can also start 10 containers beside it, without having to worry about which machine it runs on. And again, place a load balancer, this time a public one, so something that is available from the internet, in front of those containers. And let's say that it's Christmas and you need to grow your cluster very fast and add containers because you need to handle more traffic, and you can do that very easily with Kubernetes. And let's say that you have a new release of your frontend and you want to deploy the version 1.4 of your frontend. And again, it's something that Kubernetes handles very easily. You can do rolling updates of your images. So you can keep to processing requests on the old version while the new version is being deployed. Other features that Kubernetes provide is auto-scaling. So for instance, given some metrics, it will automatically grow shrink the number of replica your of containers are running. Blue-green deployment, which is basically what we're talking about with rolling release. You can run some cron jobs or jobs on it. You can also run stateful applications like database. It's not only limited to stateless microservices. And it integrates with third parties' services, with a service catalog and so on. Well, it does a lot of stuff, but how does it do it? So first, what is a cluster? That was my first question when I dig into Kubernetes. So a cluster, it's basically just a bunch of nodes. And a node, you can consider it's either a bare metal machine or a virtual machine, whatever, something which has an OS running. And from a very high view, when you want to run an app on Kubernetes, what you do is you describe your app in a YAML file, and you send it to a control plane, the part of Kubernetes that manages the cluster, and it will take care of everything for you. So you declare, it's a declarative language here, the YAML file contains only declaration about your application, and all the scheduling and the R stuff are actually done by the control plane. So you don't need to care about how, where, and who is deploying the stuff on the cluster. The architecture is pretty sound, so it's divided between the worker nodes, the nodes where the application are actually scheduled, and the control plane, which run on master nodes. So it can be one or multiple master nodes if you want high availability for your control plane. And it will eventually control the and manage the cluster. So there are a couple of components inside the control plane and the worker nodes. The most important one is the API server. As you can see in the interaction between the components, all the worker nodes eventually communicate only with the API server, and all the components in the control plane only communicates with the API server. One thing that you may see here, etcd. It's a distributed database which actually keep all the data or all the information about the cluster at a given time. It's a distributed database, a reliable distributed database that you can run also with high availability stuff. and so on. This is another diagram for the architecture. It's a bit more complete. Just put it there for completeness, and you can have a look later when you look at the slide if you want to know more about it. So the control plane, again, it has a couple of components, and you can run them on several nodes if you want high availability, and the worker nodes have as well a couple of components. The main one that you can recognize is the container runtime. So let's say Docker. For most of the Kubernetes cluster run Docker for the container runtime. It's still the more stable one, but you can use other like Rocket or Containerd, which are other container runtime which use the same interface as Docker. And the other component for worker node is the kubelet, which is the one communicating with the control node and that will do the gateway between the worker and the master. So let's dig a bit deeper into how you run an application in Kubernetes. So let's say you want to deploy an application, and in the description of the application, you reference a Docker image, which has been previously deployed to some registry, for instance, Docker Hub, and you push that to the control plane. On a regular basis, each and every kubelet on each and every worker node, they ask for the Kubernetes control plane for whether some application have been scheduled on their node. And some of them, let's say three, get a positive response from the Kubernetes from the control plane. So these three nodes know that they need to deploy the application on their on the hardware. So what the kubelet does, it then instructs the container runtime, Docker, to pull the image from the Docker registry and then run the Docker image, the Docker container on the worker node. Simple, right? So how do you interact with the cluster? Your main entry point for communicating with the cluster is what's called the kubectl, kubectl command line application. It's just a command line REST client for the API server. You could do everything with curl, but then you need to send JSON and stuff like that on the fly and need to handle authentication. Well, a bit more cumbersome, and kubectl offers a lot of nice services. So the first thing that you want to run when you start with a cluster is to ask for the versions. So for instance, if I ask here kubectl version, you get the version of the client, so the version of the command line interface that I use locally. And the server will send as well the version of Kubernetes that is running on the cluster. OK, so now I want to run a container in a pod. I want to run a container on the cluster. So I will use kubectl run. I give a name, okay, easy, and then I reference an image. So here you can see that I use gcr.io, which is not Docker Hub, it's the Google container registry. And I ask to deploy the Kubernetes Bootcamp image to the cluster. A couple of seconds later, I can ask for the list of deployments, and Kubernetes will tell me that the application has been deployed. So behind the scene, what has been done? Me, the developer, I communicated with the control plane with kubectl, running this command line, and all kubelets at one point in time will see that the application have been scheduled by the control plane on the hardware, pull the image, and run the container. Okay, you will tell me, but Michael, you told us right before that the application description is only YAML, and now you are just using a command line here. That's what that's the beauty of kubectl. It offers nice shortcut. So when you do that, what it does in the behind the scene is it creates a YAML file, the description of the application, and send it to the application server. So here you can see the YAML file for deployment. And you can see that we find again the information, so the reference to the image that we want to run, the name of the container, the port that we've specified, and so on. Okay, so now we have a container running inside our cluster. Something that you don't know yet is that when you run an application inside a cluster, it's not reachable from the outside. You can only reach it from the inside, from inside the cluster. So we want to expose it to the world, to be able to reach it from the internet or from the local network. So for that, again, kubectl offer shortcuts, so you can expose. Here we have specified the name of the deployment we've created, and we specify the port on which we want to expose this application. If I ask for details about this expose command, so I want to see the service that have been created from this expose command, I can see that a service named Kubernetes Bootcamp has been created, and I can reach this service on this table IP. Wherever the container has been provisioned, either on the worker node A, B, C, or Z, this IP will never change. Kubernetes offers me this, assure me that this IP will never change. So this means that, for instance, if I have another application inside the cluster that wants to call the other application, it doesn't need to know to reach out to one of them and to itself create a load balancer to reach one of the application running inside the cluster. It just asks, it just queries the IP of the service, and then the service itself do the load balancing between all the container running inside the cluster. Okay, so far we've created an application with a single container running, and now we want to scale it. We want to make it to scale it and deploy 4 instances of this instance, of this container. So first, I check how many instances are running. So if I get the deployment, I can see that I have only one of them, and I can just ask the scale command and give it and set the replica to number to 4, and after a while the number of instances running are actually 4, and I can see the name of all the pods running. And if I query again the same service IP, it will send me to one of these pods, one of these container. I don't have to worry about anything. That's awesome. And Kubernetes offer also by default, it's packaged with the base setup, a nice dashboard where you can see everything running and the stats, and so that's a pretty nice UI for base usage. So that's the basic how it works. Now let's dig a bit deeper and explain each concept a bit more to better understand how Kubernetes works. So the first concept is the concept of pod. A pod it's like a pPod, so it's a container for containers. So several containers can run inside the pod, but most of the pod have only one container. Container running in a single pod have something in a couple of things in common. For instance, they share the same network namespace, the same network Linux namespace. So they share the same IP. They can share some volumes, but of course they don't share the same process namespace, so they don't see process from one from each other, and so on. Something that is nice and handled by the control plane is that if inside a pod a container dies, for whatever reason, the application is bogus, there is a out of memory error or whatever, the pod will restart the container automatically. If one node die, all the pod inside the node will be eventually rescheduled to some other node. So if the machine died, the CPU burned, the hard drive fails or whatever, the control plane see that the node is not responding anymore and will reschedule the pod somewhere else. So again, it's very, very handy. You just have a pool of hardware and it auto heal, and when it cannot, it just puts the stuff somewhere else. Something that you can never have is this situation, a pod. The container in a pod are never shared between two nodes. A pod is in entirety on a node. And something that we need to know first is that each and every pod are reachable to each other. So you any pod can talk to any other, whichever machine it runs on. And it's possible because every pod run on a NATless network. So it's a software-defined network. A couple of plugins provide this software-defined network to Kubernetes, and all pods run on this network. And we'll see a bit later why it's important. And this is a basic YAML file for a pod. So YAML file for Kubernetes, you've already seen that you specify the version of Kubernetes you're targeting, the kind of the object that you're creating. So I want to create a pod, the name, and then the specification of this pod with the name of the image and a couple of other information. Other concept is in Kubernetes are labels. Labels let you categorize stuff in multiple dimensions. At first, when you start to work with Kubernetes, it may not be that useful because you only have a couple of pods. But when you start to reach thousands, hundreds, or thousands of pods, it's pretty useful to be able to query your cluster to with labels. So for instance, there I put some labels on the pods. Some of the pods are in the prod namespace. Some other are in the test namespace. Are tagged, are labeled as production or test, and some pods are about a given application, a shop, the front end, and some other are about the back end, and I want to put labels on that. And thanks to label, I can then query the cluster to get all the pods which are both of these labels and so on. And Kubernetes itself use those labels a lot for more features coming very soon. Namespaces. So no, I'm not talking about namespaces like in the Linux kernel concept. So it's not the concept that allows container to be isolated one against each other. It's the Kubernetes namespaces lets you separate resources into non-overlapping groups. And what's really nice about namespaces is that you can define quotas and permission restrictions, so that you can isolate pods that are created into a namespace. And you can also grant a user to be only allowed to create pods inside a namespace, and so on. You can also create network policies so that pods in one namespace cannot reach or cannot be reached from other pods. Replica set. Another concept which lies just above the pods. So a pod by itself, it only run as a single instance. You only have one instance of a pod. If you want to run several several replica of a pod, you need to create a replica set. And automatically the control plane will schedule all the replicas on the nodes. It ensures that at any given time, it tries to meet the replica number that you've specified. So I told you before that labels are used a lot by Kubernetes, and it's actually used by replica set. So this object replica set said that is saying that I'm a replica set for any pod that match this label. And I will create pods with this template, and any pod that I will create will have those labels. So that's how it makes the links between the metadata about the replica, the number of replicas, and the pod that it actually creates. Daemon sets, they are basically like replica sets, but they do not ensure you that a given number of pods are running somewhere in the cluster, one pod will run on each and every node on the cluster. So it's very handy for to set up infrastructure pod like log gatherer. If you want to gather all the logs from all the pods in all nodes, you want to set up a daemon set. So here you can see that we are deploying FreeMD to retrieve the logs in a central place, and we want to put one of them in each node. But here we have a very little, we have a specificities, and we said that we don't want to install that on the master nodes, on the nodes where the control plane is running, for instance. So we can create job and cron job. So I only give an example for jobs there. So jobs, they are just pods that will be killed when the process is over. There are a lot of nice features, like you can start jobs in parallel, and you can, of course, create cron jobs that will run at a given point in time or regularly. Again, we are very close to an operating system, and the concept of job and cron job, I guess, I don't need to explain it to you. But it will run somewhere on the cluster, and you don't have to care about the machine it will run on. Then we arrive at the service concept. Very important concept, because that's the concept that will allow you to reach out to your pod and to your application. So there are several kinds of services in Kubernetes, and basically the different kinds of services let you define whether the application is reachable only from inside the cluster, only from clients which have access to the nodes, or to clients which have no access to anything and need an entry point, like a load balancer or a reverse proxy. A very simple service, just declare a name, and we specify the ports, and the selector again use some labels. Here we say that we will open a service, we'll create a service for pods that that have the labels runs to the set to the name my nginx. And if we query this service, the my nginx with the name, we will see the information. So here the cluster IP. By default, we create a cluster IP, meaning that the service is only reachable from inside the cluster. So only other applications in the cluster can use this service. If we want to be able to use that from the outside, we need to create either a load balancer or an ingress service. That's what I said earlier. So the service, depending on the type of the service, it will be only reachable from inside the cluster or from outside of the cluster. But the load balancing between the replicas of your application will be handled automatically by the service definition. That's cool, but your application here, it needs to discover the service. If you need to hard code the IP of the service inside your application, then you don't gain much from Kubernetes. So you need some kind of service discovery feature. And service discovery in Kubernetes is actually quite smart, and you don't need to rely or to call Kubernetes itself to discover services. So anytime a pod is created, anytime a container in a pod is created, the environment is initialized with a couple of environment variables, and for each service available at that moment, it will create a bunch of environment variables. So here, my nginx service host, and the IP, and the port. This has a drawback. Because you need to order the creation of your services. Because of course the environment variables are not updated when service come and go. So you need to that can be flaky to rely on environment variables. Another nice service discovery feature is via DNS. So the control planes actually run a DNS server, and every time you create a service, it creates an entry in the DNS, and with a very common pattern. So the name of the service slash the name dot, sorry, the name of the namespace it runs in, and dot the cluster domain. So if you just know the name of the service, you can just use this URL, mynginx.default.svc.eclipse.nvncluster.local, and you will reach out to your service and it will be load balanced automatically. And you can also define endpoints for external resources, but we don't have time for that. Volumes. Containers, whatever you write inside the containers, if the container die, the data are gone. So you need some kind of persistent volume to be able to store your data. So Kubernetes provides that. If you already know Docker volumes, it's not the same kind of the same concept at all. It's actually much more refined. So here I just created a pod with two containers, and you can see that one volume is only available to container A, while the second volume is actually mounted in both containers at two different locations, and it's totally possible with Kubernetes to do that. There are several kinds of volumes. So one of them is an empty directory, but it's just to store temporary data. So the lifecycle is tied to the pod and not to the container itself. So it's a bit more resilient than just writing to the file system of the container. You can also mount directly a path from the node it runs on. So for instance, you can mount the Docker socket from the node inside the pod. It's not advised, but you can still do that. A Git repo and some specific stuff from cloud providers. I don't want to spend too much time on that. I much prefer to spend some time on persistent volumes, which has been added lately to Kubernetes. It lets you separate the concerns of providing some storage and using some storage. So the same way you define the shape of your application in a pod or replica set, and you let the control plane to schedule it on some nodes, and the nodes are just a service provided to you. When you want to define a volume, you just want to specify that you need a couple of gigabytes or terabytes or whatever. And you want someone to provide actually these volumes for yourself. And that's exactly what persistent volume does. So when you create a pod, you say that you create a volume that references an object called a volume claim, where you specify that I need 10 gigabytes. And the scheduler will look into the list of the volumes it has at his disposal, and will eventually bind the claim to a volume. And the volume is created by someone with more privileges, most of the time the administrator of the cluster. And this volume is linked to some network storage, NFS cluster, or whatever. It can be cumbersome to do that for each and every volume, so you don't want to ask your sysadmin to create dozens or hundreds of volumes of 10 or 100 gigabytes. So there is a layer on top of that called storage class that will automatically create persistent volume from network storage, so for instance NFS. And as long as there is enough space on the network storage, it will continue to create persistent volumes for you. Config maps. So far we have run application and we've considered that the Docker image had everything it needed to run, but sometimes you need to configure it and you want to reuse the Docker images. So you need to be able to pass some configuration. And that's exactly what config map and secrets does. And config maps are objects that you can create in via the API server, and you can mount those configs inside a pod, either via environment variables. So every entry in the config max will be a new environment variables, or you can mount config maps into a config map volume so that a new file will be created somewhere on the file system of the pod, of the containers, and it will be able to read these files. And with that, you will be able to reuse the same image to create two instances of your application, but configured in two different ways. And secrets, they are pretty much like config maps, but they are useful for storing certificates, password, and stuff like that. So don't use config map to do that. Use secrets. And Kubernetes has some very strict policies for secrets. So, for instance, they are never mounted on a physical storage. It's only in memory. So, if the Docker image, if the Docker containers die, there will be nothing on disk that can be read afterwards. The memory will be gone, and the secrets are also encrypted in etcd. If you knew Kubernetes a couple of months ago, it was not the case. So as long as you had access to etcd, you had access to all the secrets. Now they are encrypted in there. And finally, deployments. Deployments are the top level object that you will use. Actually, you will never deploy pods by yourself. You will never create replica set by yourself. And deployments are actually the kind of object we've created initially when we did a kubectl run. They rely on the fact that replica set can be composed, and replica set composed pods as well. So what deployment does is it handles the rolling upgrades and the brewing development for you. So when you have one application running, so you created a deployment saying that you want to deploy your application with three replicas, it will create a replica set for you. And this replica set will create three pods, three instances of this pod. And of course, you create as well a service for this application. Let's say you want to deploy a new version of your application. You just update the deployment saying, update the image of the of my application. What it does, it will create a new replica set, a replica set V2, and it will this replica set will create a pod with the new version of the image. Then the deployment will check whether the pod V2 is alive, and it will kill the one pod in the V1. And then it will move forward, create a new pod V2, kill one, and so on and so on. And then it will kill the first version of the replica set, and you will have your new version of your application deployed. All automatically, with all the configurations that you can think of, you can define whether you want to exceed to create all the new pods before killing any other in the old version, or how many you want to surge or not, and so on. That's just an example of what you can do, and you can configure it a lot. And Kubernetes does a lot more, actually. So you've already seen some configuration in the YAML where you can specify the resource limits a pod can request or can use. You can also create stateful sets, which are the same as a replica set, but for stateful application, like MySQL or any database, where you need only one instance to be active at one time, but you want automatic failover to another instance if the first one dies. As I told you, you can configure high availability for Kubernetes control plane. You can have auto-scaling of pods, so you can say that your replica set will automatically grow or shrink given some metrics, but you can also auto-scaling the nodes. So if you're running on a cloud provider that lets you create new nodes, new VM via an API, let's say GCP, Amazon, AWS or Azure, you can create dynamically new nodes, and the Kubernetes cluster running there can automatically create new nodes if your cluster reaches a given limit. So you'll be sure that to be able to scale your pods and not reach the limits of the size of your cluster. And you can also federate clusters, so do a cluster of cluster to be able to distribute loads between multiple regions or between multiple cloud providers if you want to be really sure to be always available anywhere in the world. I have time for one question, I guess. It was perfectly clear. Thank you. thank you. It was fast. I hope you got some of the basics of Kubernetes. I learned everything in this book. It's a really, really great book, quite TV one. It's 600 or 700 pages, but it reads very, very well. If you want to read something about Kubernetes, I cannot advise anyone else. what are the key takeaways from this? So Kubernetes, the cluster operating system, all the concepts are very sound. As you may have understood, all the concept stacks one above the other. The config maps actually mount inside the volumes. The deployment relies on replica set, which relies on pods. And everything form a wall, which is really, really impressive once you get the wall picture. It really enables better usage of the hardware by freeing you of wondering where and how to schedule stuff on that out there. And the community is so dynamic. There are new projects on top of Kubernetes every day. And if you do some microservices or containerized application, you should have a look at the Istio platform. It's a service mesh management, which lets you migrate application to the cluster world very easily. It's a really impressive project. Please evaluate the talks, especially if you want to say plus one, but even if you want to say that this talk was too fast or it was too there was too many things in this short amount of time, please do that. And thank you for your attention.